HarperCollins presents What It Takes, My Playbook on Life and Leadership by Sarina Wiegman with Jeroen Visscher. Read by Tor Leijten. For my parents Don and Beb, my twin brother Tom and my sister Diana, my husband Martin, and my daughters Sasha and Lauren. Prologue. Sunday, 16th of July, opening game of Euro 2017 in the Netherlands. The Netherlands versus Norway. As soon as I open my eyes, I know the day I've been waiting for has finally come. At precisely 6 o'clock in the evening, we're scheduled to kick off the opening game of Euro 2017 against Norway, and the Galgenwaard Stadium in Utrecht will be filled to the rafters. This day marks the beginning of our journey towards fulfilling our ultimate dream. Our primary objective is to play our best football for our supporters. When I rise from bed, the significance of the occasion strikes me with full force. Memories of my own days playing football as a young girl come flooding back to me. I remember the time when I first started playing the sport at the age of 6. Back then, women's football had only just been acknowledged by the KNVB, the Royal Dutch Football Association. However, even as a young girl, it was still impossible to join a club. Undeterred, I boldly cut off my hair and joined anyway. Despite the fact it was technically illegal, my parents always let me play football. And now, as I stand on the cusp of a new chapter in my footballing journey, the Dutch women's national football team, universally known as the Leeuwinnen, are poised to play in the Euros to a capacity crowd on home soil. It's a great irony that the Dutch word Leeuwinnen means lionesses, given that I was later to coach another team with that name. The magnitude of the moment isn't lost on me, and I can't help but feel a sense of pride and gratitude for the path that has led me to this point. It makes me happy, prompting me to reach out to my father with a message of heartfelt gratitude. I express my appreciation for the fact that we're both alive to witness this day and share with him just how fantastic it feels to be a part of it all. As I type out the words, a surge of emotion overtakes me. It's something truly special. The sheer excitement is simply indescribable. Indeed, this is just the beginning, a thrilling new chapter in my life that promises to be nothing short of extraordinary. As we board the coach for the brief journey from our training camp in Zeist, the atmosphere is palpable, full of anticipation for the upcoming match at Galgenwaard. Observing the team, I'm struck by their unwavering focus, each player with their own unique approach to achieving optimal concentration. The concept of focus is set to play a critical role this day. Several months earlier, I sought the expertise of an eye specialist as I was starting to have difficulty reading. Because of my aversion to glasses, I opted to try contact lenses, despite the specialist's warning that my eyes are too sensitive to wear them. As might be expected, the specialist's prediction proves accurate, but I find myself grappling with the question of how far I'm willing to go to avoid wearing glasses. Will I be able to reconcile this dilemma on the day of the match? The road from Zeist to the stadium is badly congested, and I can make out a long line of cars stretching into the distance. I can't help but wonder why everyone has to be on the road at that moment. Suddenly, it hits me. They're all heading to the stadium car park to catch the shuttle buses that will take them the short distance to the game. They're on their way to cheer us on. As we take the Galgenwaard exit and make a left turn towards the stadium, a wave of excitement washes over me. The sight of thousands of spirited Dutch fans congregating on the stadium concourse, eagerly anticipating our performance, gives me goosebumps. The euphoria that surges through my body is indescribable. It's a momentous day for women's football in the Netherlands, and I feel privileged to be a part of it. When I survey my surroundings, I realise that I'm not the only one moved by the scenes outside. Tears are welling in the eyes of the players and coaching staff. This remarkable and emotional moment will go down in football history. Today's the day we've been waiting for. Amid the throngs of people, I spot my husband, Martin. It's an uncanny coincidence that out of the thousands of people present, he's the one I notice first. It feels as if fate is telling me something. As soon as we enter the stadium, we receive some surprising news about the Norway lineup. Whenever we assess our opponents, we consider all the different starting options they might use. In this case, Norway have made some changes to their usual lineup and have adapted to our system. It's definitely a surprise, but we've prepared for it and are ready to face the challenge. The tears I've shed at the emotion of the occasion have dried up. But as the warm-up begins, I start to have trouble with my contact lenses. Despite having them in, I find it impossible to focus, so I rush inside to remove them. Thankfully, my eyes adjust quickly and I'm able to return to the pitch in no time. We've put a lot of effort into planning for these games, but there's always an element of uncertainty. Just 17 seconds after the referee blows her whistle to start the game, Jackie Hoonan threads a precise ball through to Shanice van der Sanden out on the right. She crosses to Lika Maritens on the far side, who manages to get past her defender and take a shot at goal. It's a close call, but doesn't quite squeeze in, the Norwegian keeper making a reflex save to her left. We don't let it get us down, though, confident that things will work out in the end. Introduction. It's the 20th of July, 2022, and are in the midst of the England versus Spain match at Euro 2022. I shift my gaze to the right, where Arjan Wøhring, the former assistant coach of the Leeuwinnen and now assistant coach of the Lionesses team, sits. I notice a hint of curiosity in his expression. A quick nod is enough to convey our understanding. We know exactly what we have to do. With just 8 minutes left on the clock, the Lionesses find themselves one goal behind in the quarter-final against Spain. We'd practiced this precise situation earlier that year during the Arnold Clark Cup, an invitational international competition. Whenever we were behind against a tough opponent, we'd immediately switch to plan B to try and score an equaliser. So now we bring on Alex Greenwood for Rachel Daly and shift Millie Bright higher up the pitch. For me to be able to make that nod is a small miracle in itself. Only at 3 o'clock this afternoon, 6 hours prior to the match, did I receive a fully negative COVID-19 test result. Managing the past few days has been challenging, as we strive to minimise the impact of the virus. Though I felt fine, I had to isolate myself for several days. As a result, I wasn't able to coach the match against Northern Ireland in person. All team discussions were conducted outside, with me wearing a face mask to maintain a healthy distance from everyone else. I am deeply concerned about the possibility of infecting players, and I don't even want to entertain the thought of that happening. Knowing that COVID-19 could impact on the Euros, and with the regular visits I made to see my gravely ill sister in the Netherlands during the lead-up to the tournament, we found ourselves forced to prepare for the possibility of my absence during a match. Our team hotel had now been set up so that I could coach the quarterfinal against Spain from there. And on the morning of the match, I'd already taken a test. So the doctor suggested I test again as late as possible before the match kicks off at 8. And I spent an afternoon walking and doing relaxation exercises to mentally prepare myself for the results, starting to doubt myself more and more. But then comes the doctor's reassuring news. My test is negative, and I'm cleared to go to the stadium. This outcome immediately gives a boost to the team. In fact, we were already 1-0 ahead. And so I'm now standing in the stadium. The nod, the substitution, plan B. Less than 2 minutes later, the cross from the right is skillfully headed down by Alessia Russo, and the incoming Ella Toon ruthlessly strikes into the net. The joy, the relief, the conviction that we're now going to win. A year of working with this team culminates in this single moment. But there's little time for celebration as the score is only level at 1-1, and we're not yet through to the semi-finals. On the pitch, I can see that the players are executing our plan. We know that plan B is only meant to secure an equaliser, and that playing like that for an extended period against a strong opponent like Spain would be naive. So Millie Bright shifts back to defence, and we return to plan A. knowing that there's drama yet to come. Spain have been mentally affected by our equaliser and are starting to falter, while the determination within our team is evident. Moreover, we appear fitter and fresher, and we can make use of that in extra time. In the 96th minute, I can see it all unfolding before my eyes. We've maintained our pressure on Spain, and after they lose the ball, Georgia Stanway receives a crucial pass in midfield. She surges forward unchallenged, and after an extra touch that deceives the goalkeeper, unleashes a powerful shot that bulges the left side of the net. It's a moment of huge release as the score shifts to 2-1 in our favour. Jorge Vilda, the Spanish national coach, now reacts swiftly by pushing Irene Paredes up from central defence, but I can sense her uncertainty in her new role. Spain are becoming sloppier, and we gain more control of the game. Pure joy fills the air when the referee blows the final whistle. I immediately look for Ariane and the rest of the staff so that we can celebrate together. This match holds immense significance for us, and winning it means the world to the team. Throughout the match, I couldn't stop myself from wondering, what if we lose to Spain? We'd played exceptionally well thus far in the tournament, and a loss would have undermined all that we'd previously achieved. But that worry has been put to rest. We're now brimful of confidence heading into our semi-final against Sweden, knowing that we've got what it takes to come out on top. We feel that we're engaged in something really special. This moment was one of the many defining moments in my coaching career in women's football. It was important because it made us realise that we had a fantastic opportunity to fulfil our dreams. It wasn't just our tactical intervention that turned the match around. As a team, we now knew we had the resilience to recover from a setback, going behind to Spain's goal, and turn things in our favour. Apart from progressing to the next stage of the competition, the feeling of confidence and belief that this victory instilled was the most valuable outcome of the quarter-final. Throughout my career, I've experienced numerous critical moments, both positive and negative, that have shaped me as a coach. The value of these cannot be overstated in such a demanding profession as football coaching. I've always been open to learning from feedback and engaging in self-reflection, and I'm fortunate to be surrounded by professionals who share the same desire as me, to improve and grow daily with the team. Embracing feedback and using it as a tool for learning is something we do collectively as both staff and players, regardless of our diverse backgrounds and cultures. It demands a lot, but it's crucial for our development. Football has been my passion since I was a young girl. The love I have for the game has always been a driving force for me, even during times when expressing that love was challenging. I remember the disapproval I had to face for being a girl playing a supposedly boys' game and cutting my hair short as a young player so I wouldn't stand out as much on the boys' team I played for. As a rookie coach, I had to work tirelessly to pursue my ambitions and make ends meet financially. I can't quite fathom how I managed, but during that period I'd just qualified as a PE teacher and combined my own football career with following the UEFA, a coaching program at the Central Institution for the Education of Sports Leaders, CIOS, studying on Sundays and working at the KNVB to pay for my studies. That's only possible if you can fall back on your family, and happily for me, that was possible. For my parents, our family, my husband Maritain, and our daughters, there was no doubt. They supported me so that I could do what I liked doing. What It Takes, my playbook on life and leadership, delves deep into my passions, football, and working with ambitious and talented people. This is where my heart lies. Football provides me with an incredible amount of energy, and it's important for me to give something back to football. People often describe what I do as remarkable, but when I reflect on my journey, I don't find it extraordinary. This is simply who I am, and I find immense joy in what others might consider challenging. Certainly, being the England women's national team coach demands a lot of me. There are no days off when you have this responsibility. Even when I had COVID-19 during Euro 2022, I felt the pressure to return as soon as possible. Despite that, of course, not being possible. Similarly, when my sister Diana passed away just before the tournament began, the Football Association gave me some leeway, but I couldn't escape the fact that all eyes were on me as the national team coach. I'm always in the spotlight, and that can be tough at times. In those moments.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.